Hello, hello, hello. I'm going to be filling in today, and we're going to take a little twist on the landscape. What we're going to do is we're going to take a look at, firstly, what we have in our packs and some of the equipment that we'll be using today, and we'll get cracking. So, first things first, we should have all had our landscape before it's downloaded with some different types of landscapes that we're looking at, some foliage, different styles of painting, and even one of John James Audubon's birds, which we'll get back to later. Today, we'll be using sheets of paper to paint on, tape that I've actually fixed right around one in the center of my board here, so that'll keep the edges clean when we peel that up. But you could just basically tap the tops and the bottoms just so that your paper doesn't move around when we're actually progressing. A pencil for drawing. Some oil pastels that we'll be using on top of our painting later on. A dish, a little mixing dish for our colors. Of course, paints. I'm going to be using this funky fluorescent and this yellow and this blue to make something really crazy. But you don't have to stick to those colors. A little white paint for blending and making funky clouds. Water, of course, for mixing your brushes. I apologize for having to move things in and out, but my table is pretty small, camera view wise. So we'll get there. Brushes. Lots of brushes, different sizes, different shapes. I just keep all of my brushes. I don't even bother to buy fancy brushes anymore. I pick up brushes in hardware stores or anywhere. This is, something a lot of artists do. One of the reasons for that is as the brushes become worn, they create really lovely textures when we are painting. So it's up to you, the types of brushes that you want to use. Coloring pencils. I have some watercolor pencils here, but again, any sort of colors that you want to use will be fine. Cloth for wiping our brushes off and spills and stuff like that. Or you might want to use paper towels. All right, cloths. Yeah. So let's get cracking. I think at some point, all of us as artists get plugged into painting landscapes. It's one of the things that we usually start off with when we get into painting, and it's one of the things that it's really democratic in that I always feel that anyone can actually do it, and I'm going to help you do the same. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at these landscapes that we already have here. And we're going to sort of reimagine if we mixed up portions of the different landscapes, what we would get. Of course, I can't hear you, but you can send in your questions and general convey the questions. And of course, Jen, you could give me a little time check so I know where I am throughout the workshop. And we're going to start by taking a look at running our fingers over the forms within the different images. And I'm gonna choose this one, and I'm going to marry it with the image of the Caribbean here because I'm from the Caribbean. I'm from the island of Trinidad, but you don't have to stick to what I'm doing. You can choose whichever image is more interesting to you, and we'll start that off. So grab your pencil, and using the images as a reference, let's try to get down what we want to actually proceed to paint. So what I'm going to do, because I quite like these little dunes, these sand dunes here, so I'm going to make a sort of tropical sand dune, if that makes sense. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to sort of try to capture that line. With landscapes, I usually find it incredibly useful to start by getting some sort of horizon line going through my image so I know where the sky should start and where the land begins. So I'm just going to follow this ridge line, in a sense, to create that shape. And then sort of look for some of these other shapes inside of here to follow. Almost like I'm tracing it with my finger and drawing it out at the same time. Doesn't have to be perfect. What we just want to do is we're going to get a basic shape of what we're going to put inside of there. And then when we get into painting, we'll work all over it. Nothing is going to be wasted. Everything will make sense. Right. So I've used this portion here. Now, I quite like these little mountains that are sort of jutting up over there. So I'm going to take a little piece of those mountains. It's sort of spiky. Again, we don't have to do it perfectly. We can just go sort of freeform with our shapes. In the end of it, we might come up with something sort of abstract-like, which is nice. Then there's a lovely reflection going on here because this is like a lake. So I'm going to sort of give myself that lake shape inside of there and create a similar shape. Again, doesn't have to be perfect. We just let it flow freely and see what we get. Lovely. So we have our sky area. We have our little sci-fi looking mountains there. A little lake area here with a reflection of the mountains. And then we have our sand duney things going on here. So already you can see we have a sense of what kind of landscape that we're going to create. The lovely thing about doing things like this in a spontaneous manner is that you never really know what you're going to get at the end. And that's a beautiful thing. Can you see the drawing well, Jen? Yeah?
Yes, we can see that, Richard. Thank you.
Okay, great. All right. So let's add some trees. Like I said, I'm from the Caribbean, so I'm going to stick some palm trees and some coconut trees in there. I actually like how this line of trees looks. So I'm going to put in the trees, but I'm going to do my trees with a sort of twist. If we look at these, the trees here are drawn. These are, I think these would be date palms, I believe, right? But I think they're drawn in a little different style. So this is a photograph, and this obviously is a painting. And one of the things that I like to do when drawing foliage is I like to draw foliage the way architects draw. So quick primer on how architects draw foliage. A small bush would be a circle with another circle next to it and a few strokes like that. A tree would be a stroke like this with a circle and a few strokes there. Grass would be, it's very simple. It's basically how you imagine it. So when I'm drawing coconut trees or palm trees, I basically draw a line and something like an asterisk on the top. And this becomes my trees. So I'm going to add a little bit of that into this drawing. Of course, you can feel free to copy the trees from the images there, or some of what's going on here, or some of what's going on in this image, but this image is rather dense. So maybe we'll just stick to this one with the palms, all right? So let's get that going. So I'm gonna put a line in here. So that'll be basis of my coconut tree. This is gonna be a weird landscape, but hey, if it works, then we could pull some branches here. Put another one here. And trust me, it'll all make sense later on. Let's add a little, some more trees here. So we get a sense of depth going on. And some of the little bushes. Maybe a tree. I mean, it's up to you. We're just going to create this weird landscape. And of course, if this is our lake here that we're going to do, it means that we're reflecting what's on the shore in the lake. Right. Okay. So now that we are suitably confused and we have our drawing in place, and you don't have to go as fast as I'm going. You could take it at your own speed and you could keep going on with the workshop even when we are finished. You just do it at your own speed. But basically, I'm just going to show you some techniques that we do. All right. So we're now going to look at filling in the sky. Again, I like to do things differently. So I'm going to get my plate and I'm going to use this lovely fluorescent color here. So I'm going to make a sort of alien sky fluorescent color. All right. Bring this around. So add a little water. Mix your painting. If you're using watercolor, you add a little water to it to mix it. I'm using acrylic, so I sort of have to balance what I'm doing because acrylic tends to dry quickly, but you're not stuck doing that. Then let's just get in there and block that area in. Again, the lovely thing about using old paintbrushes is that you get these lovely brush textures because they aren't perfect. And a lot of painting really is the texture that you get when you're working with brushes. And I know quite a few artists who take their brushes and they beat the hell out of them and they keep them there. They save everything. Let's block that in there. Don't worry about covering that pencil because you'll be able to see pencil underneath the color and that'll add a lovely guide.
Richard, can you tell us how you've selected the colors that you're using today?
Oh, I like bright colors. I come from a Caribbean country. We're accustomed to bright colors. Most of my painting and most of my work, I always use bright colors. I'm not very good with muted colors. I can if I have to, but I just like things that look like, I read a lot of comic books as a kid. And I guess the first color palette that I got accustomed to was the things that I saw in the Sunday papers. And those were bright yellows and pinks and reds and greens and stuff like that, primary colors. And I've just stuck with using primary colors ever since. Right, so now we've sort of blocked in our area for our sky, right? And of course we have these little cast mountains inside of there. And I'm just gonna make a slight, another tone, just sort of water this down a little bit again and make a light wash inside of here so that we know that this lighter area is our I guess, snow-capped mountains in a strange sci-fi Caribbean setting, if that makes any sense. But hey, that's the beauty of art. You can create any world you want. Right. Yeah, so we have that in there. Okay. Now, we're gonna look at filling in this area here. At the end of it, we should have something that's a little weird, a little abstract, a little groovy all at once. So I'm gonna go in there with some yellow. And for that, I'll use another brush. The water in here. And we just sweep that in.
Richard, we've had a question come through from Nadia, who wants to know, does the order matter if you are using watercolour? For example, do you always start with the sky or the biggest area, or does it depend on the medium that you're using?
I think it depends on where you want to paint from. Sometimes when I'm painting, I'm usually painting on two or three paintings at the same time. And the way I approach painting is I don't want to get bored doing it. So I never stick to any real rules. Sometimes I'll start, if I'm doing a landscape with the sky, sometimes I'll start with the thing that interests me the most. I think what interests me the most about this image was the possibility of this big band of color inside of here and creating something that is a little abstract in terms of form. So I guess that's why I wanted to start with that major color up there. Because you see, as it is, we could actually see our image coming at us already. But it's really up to you where you want to begin or where you want to start. Sometimes I paint on, as I say, three paintings at once, and I'm painting over here in one corner. I'm using the same color on another painting, and I do that. No hard and fast rules at all. Okay, quite like that. All right, now. So now we have this little icy mountain, pinkish mountain thing here, this sky going on. And then we have another level in front, and maybe I'll turn that into a beach. I guess I'll use some ochre. Sort of get this in here. Interestingly enough, I first got into doing landscapes. I do them on and off, but I don't do much of them. But I first got into doing landscapes by looking at Bob Ross and the Joy of Painting. Bob Ross was talking in very calm tones. And we talked here about happy little clouds. And actually, we're gonna make some happy little clouds in here. Just for the hell of it. Have some fun.
Just to give Richard a time check and everyone that's joining us today, we are halfway through today's workshop. And I'd like to let everyone know, if you're trying to use the raise hand function, we're not using that today. So please, can you pop your query into the chat function, or you can use the Q&A box and we'll get to it there.
Thank you, Jen. Okay, So now that we have this yellow area in here, and we have that pink up there, and we have our little mountain area going on there. This is the water area, and what we have to do is to create a sort of reflection. So I'm going to use the same, the leftover from that pinkish color that I had there, and I'm just going to lightly wash that in. Lightly wash that in there, gently. And you'll notice I'm not trying to stick within any lines or zone. I'm just sort of letting the brush do what it has to do. We don't have to worry about that because we're going to get back to those edges to add some details later using our pencils, or in my case, my pastels. So I got that. So that's a little reflection there. And I think I'm going to add a little blue in here. Right. Let's clean this off a little bit. Add a little white to that. So you see what I'm doing is I'm totally taking the colors that you would expect in the places that you would normally see them in terms of a painting or a magazine or a photograph of a landscape, and then just tossing them around. And it changes your whole perception of the work that you're making. I'm using the acrylics in a pretty solid way. Yeah, like that.
So you've got a really global audience for our workshop today. We've got participants joining us from Australia, Chicago, and a big hello to everyone that's joining us from Queen Mary's Lavender Ward. If you'd like a little shout out or to say hello and let Richard know where you're joining us from, you can do so using the chat function or the Q&A bot.
That's lovely. So nice. Hello, everybody. Okay. Let's sweep that. Yeah. Okay. Right. So at this point, we pretty much have our image almost totally covered. Now I'm just adding my trees. I'm going to mix in the blue. Just make some swirls in there. Some reflections going on in here. I'm going to use the same color. Just pull. Again, we're not looking for precise, we just want to be free with what we're doing. I'll use a smaller brush.
Richard, we've got another question about the type of paper that you're using. Is that a special paper that particularly holds acrylic paint well?
Yes, actually. And this isn't a plug for Winsor & Newton, but I'm actually using a Winsor & Newton watercolor block. It holds water very well. It holds acrylic very well. And it lets you really take your time and and add textures and beat things into it. It really holds up. It really holds up well. Take a little bit of this blue. Let's add some stuff, add some details in here.
We've got lots more people letting us know where they're joining us from today. A big hello to Denisa, who's joining us from London. And hi to Anne, who's joining us from North Carolina.
Hi. Little details in here. Okay. So at the end of it, we may have something that looks a little weird, but a little abstract at the same time. And it's all good. So now, take a little bit of white in here. I'm going to go in this area that we had. Just sort of knock some white into that area.
I'd like to give a huge hello to Hannah and everyone joining us from Bluebell Deaf Unit.
A little highlight. Bushes. Yeah. Okay. So at this point, you should have your general image laid out. And now we can actually go in and play with some more details. Like I said, you can use your color and pencils to work on top of the image, or you could use color pastels. I like using color pastels. It's something that I learned looking at Susie Hamilton, who's this amazing artist that I absolutely love. Work, it allows you to be quite free. The lovely things that happen when you're painting with oil brushes, you get all these little lines in there, lovely things, right? So I'm going to go in now and I'm just going to draw all over the top of this using my oil pastels. So I'm going to come back in to this area with the tree and I'm going to freely add some lines in there. Let's freely add the lines. Now again, you don't have to do what I'm doing. You can basically take it at your own pace, however you feel you'd like to proceed. You can do it at your own speed. I keep everything, even the ones that are going down to little nubs like that. Use that. And basically, put a little detail around this. Color. think I want to give some definition to my bushes here. So remember, I was telling you how architectural foliage. So now I'm going to put in a little mark tree. Add a little brush there. Add some marks since this is supposed to be a reflection. One of the things that I like to do, because I'm a right-hander, but you might find that it's really lovely when you want to add textures to paintings, especially when you're drawing, switch hands. Use your non-dominant hand and try to create some marks. It gives some really wild lines. Some scrolls. And maybe, just for the hell of it, I'm going to add, in honor of Bob Ross, a little happy cloud. Just a weird little happy cloud. Eric, you have white in there. So let's get a little. Put a little cloud shape in there. Put a couple. So that's my cloud. I'm going to use my little stubby blue. Cloud shape. I like to paint and draw in a very free and expressive manner. It's more fun. Yeah. How are we for time, Jen?
So we've got 10 minutes left of today's workshop.
Yes. Add this inside here. Take this blue paint and make a sort of border. Yeah. Then let's get a little crazy and add some textures inside of here. So more little. At this point now, I'm just really embellishing. Got some interesting marks. And yeah, I think this is my little odd and crazy funkadelic landscape.
Of course, I have some really lovely comments come through, Richard. Janetta says that this is such beautiful work, and Nadia says those colours are luscious.
Thank you. Thank you. Painting is something for me, when I'm doing it, I like to be as surprised as the person who's going to see work after I make it. And I don't know if that makes sense. But sometimes you could get so plugged into making something that you're seeing it all the time that you become bored by it. So I normally start off with a plan as to what I'm going to make. And then when I get plugged into it and I start going, I go in different directions all at once because I kind of want to surprise myself at the end. And Yeah, I'm just taking this painter's tape. I mean, you could use other tape. You could use masking tape, but I like painter's tape because painter's tape doesn't rip paper. Even the lightest of papers, it won't rip. It's so low tack, but it seals enough to lock in cover. Here you have it. Let me just hold this up for the camera. Can we see that? Yeah.
That's absolutely fantastic, Richard. And just a reminder to everyone that just because we've whizzed through the workshop today, we'd really encourage you to take some extra time this afternoon or whenever you'd like to pick up again on this workshop and continue in your own time. The recording will be uploaded to both Hospital Room's YouTube channel as well as Anthropology's Vimeo page. Mm-hmm. If anyone has any final comments or questions for Richard before we wrap up today's workshop, please do put those into the Q&A box below.
Green inside of there. Think about it, you always look at your work and you see other things that you could have done. Or sometimes you have to know when to stop. But
you've had some really lovely comments and lots of thank yous coming through, Richard. People saying they're totally inspired, that this is an excellent workshop, the picture's magnificent, and it really reflects the Caribbean country of Trinidad.
Oh, lovely. Thank you. My little sci-fi version of Trinidad.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Richard. And just once again, thank you so much for stepping in at the very last moment when sadly Shutupa Biswas, our original artist, couldn't be with us today. We really appreciate you being here with us, Richard, and kind of making the workshop your own. So yep. Thank you so much. Everyone is so inspired, and we've had a beautiful comment come through from Sharon, who says this is the best painting class she's ever been to in over 20 years, and she's never felt so free in her painting. So thank you.
Thank you. That's lovely. That's really lovely.
Beautiful.
I'm just looking forward to seeing what you make and what you put up there. So do put your things up. You know, let us see what you've created after the workshop, you know.
Absolutely. And thank you so much to everyone that's joined us today. As we mentioned earlier, we can't wait to see your uploads into our online gallery. And you can upload those at hospital-rooms.com. Thank you so much to Richard Mark Rawlins once again for such a fantastic and vibrant workshop today. And thank you to our wonderful friends, supporters, and people that have joined us via Anthro events. So I'm now going to launch our end of workshop poll. This will give us an indication of how you found the workshop today, how Richard has adapted it, whether you've enjoyed it, and will give us a lot of feedback that we can work on. So I'm going to launch that poll now, and we'll let that run through to the end of today's session. Thank you so much to everyone that's taking the time to answer that. We'll just give that another moment before we swap back to our slideshow. Fantastic. Thank you so much, Richard, and thank you everyone that's answered our poll today. So if you're still here with us, I'd like to share the story of Hospital Rooms and the workshop today has come about. So we are a London-based arts and mental health charity, and we transform inpatient mental health units with contemporary art. We began the digital art school in response to COVID-19 lockdowns when our work in person in mental health units was put on hold. The Digital Art School has become a wonderful way for lots of us to join together globally and across the country, and a way to kind of share in that creative expression. We have a vast library of all of our past workshops on our YouTube channel. You can search for those by hit searching hospital rooms into the search bar at the top of the screen. And we'd also really encourage you to upload your works to our online gallery as well. You can do so by visiting hospital-rooms.com. Today is the last session of our current term, but you can join us again for our brand new term, which starts again on the 18th of November. And that will be with Studio Campos, who will be leading a drawing and painting workshop, recreating Loras, one of their most popular works. Thank you once again so much to Anthropology for your fantastic support. Thank you to everyone that's joined us via Anthro events. And thank you to our wonderful wards and units that join us every week, and to those of you watching this back on demand. We'll see you again on the 18th of November at 2 p.m. Thank you so much, everyone.